Our third and final speaker tonight is Dr. Terrell Strayhorn, professor and director of the Center for Higher Education Enterprise at The Ohio State University, a renowned student success scholar, highly acclaimed public speaker, and award-winning writer. Dr. Strayhorn is the author of 10 books, over 50 book chapters, and more than 150 journal articles and conference papers. His work focuses on student access and achievement, equity and diversity, impact of college on students, and student learning and development. In 2014, Dr. Strayhorn became the youngest full professor in Ohio State's history. So please welcome Dr. Strayhorn to the stage.
All right, and good evening, and another round of applause for Donnell, please, for that wonderful introduction. And it's my great pleasure to be here tonight and to have the opportunity to talk just for a few moments about college student success, to talk about some of my research, and to accomplish the things that were asked of me. And so those things were really easy. When I got this assignment, I was to, one, talk about data and research. I was to talk some practice. I was to tell a story. I was to educate, to inspire, and to motivate, and do all of that in less than about 15 minutes. And then to top it all off, they now expect me to do this in the presence of three amazing leaders from my own institution who are here in the room. My Vice President of Student Affairs, Dr. Javon Adams-Gaston. If you'll wave and thank my Vice President. Vice Provost Sharon Davies, who's right there in the back, if you'll wave for her. And our Vice President for Government Affairs, Blake Thompson, who's in the room somewhere, or maybe, yes, over here in this corner. So this is a major setup that I'm supposed to accomplish all of this in 15 minutes with three incredible folks in the room. And then, to top it all off, amazing presidents like Walter Kimbrough and Beverly Tatum, Michael Lomax from UNCF. Just give everybody a round of applause, please, for being here tonight. So clearly I will fail at this endeavor, but I'm going to do my best to sort of cover some information, talk about research, highlight a couple of points of practice, and I'll close on a story. So I'm Terrell Strayhorn, a professor of higher education at The Ohio State University and director of the Center for Higher Education Enterprise. We call it CHE. CHE is a research center focused on college student success, and we have four priority areas at CHE: college access, affordability, engagement, and excellence, the things that everyone's been talking about tonight. If I had more time, I'd go through all of those four priority areas, but just trust me, they're good priority areas, and we're striving to do good work in those areas. And if you can imagine it, the sort of short of all of it is that we try to expand access, open access for people. If you're going to do that, you got to keep college affordable. If you want to keep college affordable, it's going to cost you not only your own money, but you're going to have to engage with people in this enterprise. We were talking about this at my table, talking about who are our partners in all of this work. And then the foundation of everything we do in higher education should be to ensure excellence in higher education. It's already been talked about. If you're on social media, so am I. I've already put a couple of tags up there, TL Strayhorn, and so is CHE_OSU. Here's the data about college students in this country. We have an enormous enterprise, enormous system in this country, about 21 million college students who are enrolled across 4,300 colleges and universities, about half of those, two-year community colleges. We also know a lot about students. About a third of college students today identify, much like our MCs, as first-generation college students, the first in their family to go to college. So we have done an enormous sort of work in this country to open up access for women, open up access for students who are living with disabilities, to open up access for racial and ethnic minorities. Every February, I remind our country that there are more African Americans in higher education than was once legal in this country. That's what this great country can do. Yeah, that's a good state. I didn't even plan for that, right? This time of season. This is still a great country, so we should clap for the United States and the fact that we've opened up Regardless of what your political leanings are, it's a great country, and we've opened up access. But here's what we know. As was mentioned in Dr. Hill's talk, we've opened up access, but our access work has not been matched on the same front of success. We know that students are enroll in higher education nowadays, and not all of them finish. So I always like to say, much like Vince Tinto, access without success is useless. What's the point of gaining access to college for a day or for a semester, if at the end of it you don't have a degree to hold? I'll snap for myself on that one. You know, this is the whole point. I always tell students, what's the point of going to a wonderful institution like Vassar or like The Ohio State University and graduating at the end of it and not having taken part of the experience? What's the point of going to a research university if you've never done research? What's the point of going to a liberal arts college if you're not going to go to a concert every now and again? So we have to push students, compel students to take part in the experience. So access should be matched with success. And success is not just grades. It's not just graduation, although that's critically important, but also maximizing on the experience that we call college. And I've learned over the years a couple of things. One, we can't graduate a student that we don't enroll or one that we won't educate. So we have to take risk. You're looking at a risk because I was this size when I went to college, but I came in today after landing and I went to the registration table and Rochelle said I could say this and she said, are you a kipster? I didn't know what that meant. But I learned from Richard that you have big kipsters. So I guess I'm a big kipster. Turns out I'm not a student, I'm an adult. This is the biggest I've ever been my entire life, but that's okay because it doesn't matter what size you are, it matters most what your mind's able to do. Where your mind takes you. And sometimes when I'm in front of people, I forget that I'm 5'6" and a half. Because when I'm speaking, when I'm acting, when I'm doing what I do, when I teach, when I do research, I feel 6'7". And that's what we want for our students. Not just KIPP students, but all students. For them to cultivate their intellectual abilities to the point where they are larger than life, where they can see themselves out living outside of poverty. Before you even get there, let your mind transplant you there. So this is what the power of education is about. This is what I want to talk about for the remainder of my time with you. We know that a lot of factors matter when it comes to student success. And on the screen, you see things like academic integration. We were talking about it at my table, that students have to engage with faculty in meaningful ways. They have to be engaged with faculty in the classroom, outside the classroom. They also have to form relationships with peers. This is Vince Tinto's retention model that simply says students sort of start with background traits, family background and certain attributes, and that all of that then moves into the college environment that shapes their commitments, their commitment to the degree, the commitment to the institution. And then they have that thing we call an experience. And that experience is what he called academic and social integration, getting involved in the social and the academic life of college. And as a result of that experience, then either students are more likely to drop out or they will stay. I've learned over the years that there's other stuff that matters. One of the factors that matter a lot is belonging. Students who feel a sense of belonging succeed. So then our job is, how do we cultivate this belonging for them? First, let's talk about what belonging is. It's the basis of this book that I wrote in 2012 and also my TED Talk. Here's my favorite slide about belonging. You get everything I have to say about belonging in almost a single slide. And that's simply to say that this is the foundation of what Abraham Maslow talked about with humans. Humans have basic needs. He says that all humans, everyone in this room, needs air, water, food, shelter, and sex. See, I knew you weren't gonna laugh because higher ed audiences never laugh when I say the word sex. Students laugh, they think it's so hilarious. They're like, oh my God, tweet that he said sex, but we don't laugh. I don't know why, if we don't get enough sex, I don't know what's going on in higher education, but Maslow said it, not me. He says after we fulfill our most fundamental needs like air, water, food, shelter, and yes, sex, higher order needs emerge. Now, years ago, I would have jumped to the yellow band because that's where we're gonna go tonight, but I wanna pause for about 30 seconds and highlight something that a first generation Latina student in Memphis, Tennessee reminded me of. She said, Dr. Strayhorn, don't move over that blue one too fast, because safety and security is really important to us. And all of us in higher education have seen Title IX cases swirl all across the country, and it's because safety and security are really important. And it's not just physical safety, although students cannot learn in spaces where they feel physically harassed, unsafe, insecure, not protected. But also, she said, it's financially secure. It's really hard to study and take a test when you're worried about your bills being paid. when you're worried about, and not just your bills, but if you're first generation, or if you're a student of color, or dare you be a first generation student of color who's also low income, living at the intersections of all of that, taking a chemistry test, thinking about whether mom and dad's bills are paid, or baby brother's taken care of. Who's helping the students shoulder all of that enormous responsibility? Belonging really matters there. After those fundamental needs are met and satisfied, then our love and belongingness needs emerge. By a show of hands, how many of you in here want absolutely no friends ever in life? See, I've never met, that's not true, I've met one person at Fairleigh Dickinson College. He works in student affairs. If you ever meet him, don't be his friend. He doesn't want friends. But everyone else in the country wants friends. We all want to feel friends. Everybody wants to know their name. Everybody wants to feel connected and supported. This is what belonging is all about. And after we satisfy our belonging needs, look what emerges. Those things that most people who are college student educators and K-12 educators care about most, self-actualization and creativity, self-sufficiency. There's another slide that I could have had that also maps that purple box or purple pyramid at the top onto the top 10 things that employers want college graduates to have. Things like creativity. They want them to be able to see connections, playfulness, be able to work on teams. So the point I'm making here is, on this side of the pyramid, for those of us who are in higher education, the only thing that stands between our basic operations, where students sort of enter, and our mission, because most of our missions include words like creativity and vitality and creation of knowledge, the only thing that stands in the middle of us getting to our mission and fulfilling our mission is belonging. For students, the other side of the slide, where they begin in college and their highest potential, right dab in the middle, is belonging. It's the crux. It's what we need in order to fulfill both our institutional missions and our personal missions. Here's what I have for belonging. You can take a picture of this. I see lots of people taking pictures. So these are seven core elements of belonging. Basically, everybody wants to belong. It drives us. It drives human behavior. Anybody in here, by a show of hands, a member of a fraternity or a sorority? Keep your hands up if you paid to be a part of it. You see, this is how badly people want to belong. They'll join, they'll pay for it. People will pay to belong. They will pay to be a part of something bigger than themselves. This is how critical it is to us as humans, and it takes on heightened importance, as mentioned on the slide, heightened importance in certain contexts at certain times. For students, college is a time, no matter their age, where they're sorting through a number of questions. Questions like, who am I? What am I trying to do? Where am I going in life? Why am I here? And a lot of that spins, the answer of that spins on their connections and relationships with other people, faculty, staff, and peers. Belonging is critically important. Over the years, I've seen that those students who belong have higher retention rates, as shown on this slide, and they actually have higher GPAs. But belonging's not just important. The most exciting thing about belonging is it actually is responsive. We were talking about this a little bit earlier at my table. Responsive to intervention. We can do something to help students feel a sense of belonging. We can do things today. So let's close next couple of minutes just with a couple of points here. So the first thing we can do is we can maintain high expectations. This is really easy for a KIPP audience because KIPP is founded on these sort of principles, believing that all students, like myself, can belong. And not only belong, but they can excel, they can exceed. Believe that all students are achievers. But this really pushes you to also check your implicit and explicit bias. So I always like to say to people that I'm the fun size. Even fun size people can learn. People who have the fortunate pleasure of being the same color of me can also learn. And it turns out that I had a teacher in third grade who needed to be here tonight and hear this, who thought for some reason every person who's born in this skin color is inadequate, inefficient, or somehow lacking. She would often say to me things like, hey, Terrell, for this assignment you're gonna have to write, and you're gonna have to write a lot. It's like 3 pages, but what she didn't know is that I love to write. And now as a university professor, it took me years, though, to reconnect with that love, because it takes one day, 1 second, 1 minute for an educator to tell a student they're not capable of doing something, but it takes years for that student to recover from the impact of that educator, which is why we got to remember high expectations of all students. Check our own bias so we can make sure that all students here say that you're able to do it. That we also encourage students to excel. And then something I've learned over the years from students, that we normalize their marginalizing experiences. Whether you know it or not, students walk around daily telling themselves that they cannot do it, that they're the only ones who failed the quiz. They're the only ones who didn't make the team. They're the only ones who weren't elected. They're the only ones like them from that neighborhood who got to this school, and they need us to remind them that, no, you're not the only one. And in fact, you know, many of us have offices that have pictures of our students or note cards from students over the years. Those are powerful tools for us to help a student realize, you know what, look at this story of this student who graduated. You know what? They failed their first chemistry test too. And they ended up majoring in chemistry. Now they're in medical school. So many students think that they have one setback and it sets them back for a lifetime. Normalizing those experiences can help. Also, helping students realize that competence and confidence are not the same thing. That we can raise students' confidence. Just because you can do something doesn't mean you're actually going to do it. Social psychological research over years shows us that people don't actually try things until they honestly believe that they're able to do it. I remember when I was a little kid, they would tell me at church, come on up and speak. And I was like, I can't speak. And here I am speaking without notes, you know, for minutes and minutes and minutes. It was always in me. Someone just had to help me get confident in that, help me build my skills in that. And so confidence is exciting because we've had decades of research that show us, like on the screen, there are three ways you can raise confidence. First, verbal persuasion. Look at the person next to you and say, you can do it. Now, I don't know what you want them to do, but they can do it because you told them they can do it. Verbal persuasion works. The second thing is vicarious experiences. You don't always have to do it yourself. You can watch people do it. And somehow, by watching people do things, role modeling or emulating, you yourself feel compelled to do it yourself. And then third, mastery experiences. Give them opportunities to develop the very skills that you want them to have. We can help them rewrite negative scripts. This is simply to replace their scripts. My grandmother, when she was living, she would say things like, I remember she would say, don't say can't. Can't is a cuss word. And I remember growing up, I was in fourth grade before I realized can't isn't a cuss word. So I'd be sitting in class and someone would say, I can't. Don't say, oh, I'm gonna tell the teacher you're cussing. And then I learned it's not a cuss word, but I didn't know that adults lied at that point. So my grandmother said, can't's not a cuss, she said it's a cuss word. And this is what we should teach students, is that you don't say can't. Don't tell yourself you can't do something. Replace it. I can do something. I don't know how to do it yet, but I'm capable of learning it. I can find support to be better at it. All of this is about mindsets. You can help students develop growth mindsets. There's a talk tomorrow or session tomorrow I saw in the conference program all about growth mindsets. If you want to know more about it, go there. But this idea that you can learn, you can grow, you can expand, develop new talent. I myself realized, you know, I'm not very good at basketball. And I'm not very good at, and I have all the evidence in the world that I'm not good at basketball. I remember like in grade school, whenever I caught the ball and people started charging me, I would start double dribbling and all that stuff. I scored more points for the opposing team than my own. I'm just not good at basketball. But one day I decided that I would try spelling and science and math. And I developed this knowledge that I'm really good at those things. Every girlfriend I've ever had, I got her first by doing her homework. Love came later. Don't judge. It's a safe space. And so what you have to do is teach students. This is really, really important stuff. And KIPP can do this, and so can everyone in higher education. That is helping students figure out, what are your skills? What are your talents? And I don't care that I'm not good at basketball. And people say, I've never met a black guy who can't jump. Yes, you have. But guess what? I may not be able to jump, but I can write. I can think, I can critically analyze, so can students. Finding out what are my capabilities and then learning how to deploy them to solve their problems. That's really important, rewriting negative scripts. And then finally, helping them foster these growth mindsets I'm talking about, all of that connected will get them to belonging, because belonging really matters. Someone at my table asked one of the ways in which you can learn how to foster belonging in a large classroom. The first way you do it is by learning people's names. You want strategies about that? We'll talk about that tomorrow. Secondly, signal that students matter. Let them know that you know them as more than just their name, more than just a person who's in the class. We can do this even institutionally. How do we signal to students and certain groups of students that they matter? Look around this room. I had to tell you, when I came in tonight for the run-through, I noticed the signs. I always notice the signs when it's people of color and, you know, graduation caps and so forth. Those things signal that these people matter and they're academic and they're successful. How many images like this show up on your campuses, show up in your classrooms, show up in your offices? We should be asking ourselves campus ecology kinds of questions. Where do you pick up messages about people, and what are the messages we're sending through our news, through our media, through our websites, through our newsletters, through the signage on the wall? And then finally, that we teach cultural values, norms of membership. Now, I told you I had to talk data, talk practice, and then tell a story. So in my last minute or so, I say, here's a story. Those of you who know me very well or know me well enough know that in November 2013, I lost someone who was near and dear to me, my maternal grandmother, Creola Evelyn Warner. I called her Ma. My grandmother was a teacher, a musician, and a singer. She would teach me hymns growing up. She was the first person who taught me Amazing Grace. She was the first person who taught me there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. But I was 7 years old in her kitchen watching her make breakfast. When she turned to me, she said, Rel, now this is my favorite song. I never heard her label a song that way her entire life. She said, this is my favorite song. And the words are quite simple. The words are, there's a bright side somewhere. There's a bright side somewhere. Don't you give up until you find it. There's a bright side somewhere. And my grandmother had this strategy, this way of teaching. She would start, she said, there's a bright side somewhere. She said, Rel, now you take the next verse. And I said, there's a brighter side somewhere. Together in unison, we say, don't you give up until you find. There's a bright side somewhere. November 2013, my grandmother suffered an aneurysm after her 88th birthday. She was immediately hospitalized. I flew to see her. When I got to the hospital, I learned that the aneurysm had knocked out most of my grandmother's functionality. She didn't know my name. She didn't know her daughter's name, her only daughter's name. She didn't know the president of the United States or a teacher, didn't even know the day of the week. I sat with her for a few days and took care of her, like good people do. That's what we do. We stay together because we are better together. So I stayed close to my grandmother, took care of her, washed her face, washed her hair. I'm not too proud to say any of those things because this woman had made so many sacrifices for me. I am who I am because of my grandmother. So she hadn't said words in weeks. November 21st, I went to bed, and the nurse came in and asked me if I wanted a cot. I said, no, I don't need a cot. I'm going to sit beside my grandmother, and I held her hand, and I drifted off to sleep. Around about 1:44 a.m., I was awakened out of my sleep by the most violent shaking of my grandmother's hand. I turned my head, and my grandmother was just looking at me. I tried to find the button to press for the nurse to call her, and as I turned my head right, I heard in my left ear, after weeks of silence, my grandmother said, there's a bright side somewhere. Couldn't find the button, but I knew my line had come up, so I turned to her and said, there's a brighter side somewhere. She still remembered to join me on the last verse. Don't you give up until you find it. There's a bright side somewhere. Richard opened with the glass. I close with a story that even as educators, our job is to remember that even despite the challenge, despite the heartache, despite the setback, shrinking resources, political debates, policies that serve as barriers for us, that there is always a brighter side. Our job is to never give up until we find it. Never give up until the next first generation students get into college. Never give up until the next low income student succeeds. Never give up until we open up access for everyone and match access with success. When we strive to work together, realizing we are better together, we will usher in a day where all students will have the same story that Donnell has, the same story that Ileana has, and that is that education does pay off. Thank you.